Over the centuries, the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire grew to be the pinnacle of civilization. Its high walls attracted and protected architecture, literature, science, and art belonging to different regions and eras. On April 13, 1204, the city fell to the crusading force of Enrico Dandolo, and the forces that took it would go on to commit one of the greatest crimes against humanity as they feasted on the corpse of the fallen empire, wreaking havoc on the most prosperous city in the world. In this video, we will give an account of losses in art and material culture during the sack of Constantinople. The sponsor of today's video, Magellan TV, is the favorite documentary platform of kings and generals. We've been enjoying our Magellan TV subscription and hope that our viewers love it too. Magellan TV is a documentary streaming service run by filmmakers that has over 3,000 documentaries, among them hundreds of historical documentaries. Fans of Roman history will surely enjoy the 6-episode I, Caesar, The Rise and Fall of the Roman Empire series. We also recommend The Hidden History of Rome and Meet the Romans, as both of these titles provide so much fun knowledge of Roman history. You can watch both anytime, anywhere, on your television, laptop, or mobile device, and it's compatible with most devices. Our viewers can now take advantage of an exclusive offer, 30% off an annual membership. This gives you an entire year for less than $3.50 a month. Every documentary we've watched has been worth double that, and there are now 3,000 in the Magellan TV collection. This offer is available to returning users too. Simply click on the link in the description to claim your discounted annual membership today. Support our channel and do that at try.magellantv.com/kingsandgenerals. Start your free trial today. As depicted in our previous episode, the Crusaders quartered in three different parts of the city, which had by this point sustained heavy damage from three separate fires. One of the leaders of the Crusade, the Marquis of Montferrat, Boniface, took the palace of Bucolion, where he found all the prominent ladies of the court. Count Baldwin of Flanders took quarters in the palace of Blakeney, while the Doge Enrico Dandolo occupied the Hagia Sophia. Alexios III had left with the entire treasury, and the Crusaders were determined to receive what they were promised by Alexios IV. But having learned their lesson from the infighting that occurred over spoils in Zara, they laid out a plan on how to sack the city. The citizens were not to be harmed, especially if they were Latins, and all the gathered spoils would be collected in designated piles within several churches, and then divided equally, half going to the Venetians and the second half to the Crusaders. Every major leader condemned acts of violence and selfishness under the threat of excommunication. Despite these clear instructions, many men turned to savages as they took spoils for themselves, while raping and killing innocent citizens. One particular episode describes a knight carrying loot on his shield, stacked up to his chin. That knight and many others were hanged immediately. One of the primary contemporary chroniclers, Nicetas Conietes, describes an event from which we can draw several conclusions. As he and his wife were attempting to leave the city 5 days after it fell, they saw a young girl who was grabbed by a knight and dragged through the streets until he barred the door of his newfound home with her inside. The act was reported to other knights nearby, who immediately threatened him with death if he did not release the girl, at which point he obeyed. Yet again we see the division in the Crusader camp, with some choosing to disobey direct orders, but most following them out of discipline, oaths, or fear. But while they did their best to limit violence, their greed rolled over the city, destroying artifacts, monuments, and works of art. The imperial treasury was empty, so the Crusaders began stripping metal ornaments, ivory containers, pearls, and precious stones, melted down chalices and relics, plundered churches, and the stone homes of the rich, which were left exposed by the fire after it devoured the timber houses of the commoners. Around half of the population of the city was left homeless and became refugees, making their way to Bulgaria and the new successor states. The Church of the Holy Apostles, also known as the Imperial Cemetery, which for more than 700 years was the second most important church in the city, was already ransacked by Alexios III when he was gathering a tribute that was demanded of him from the Holy Roman Emperor Henry VI, but that did not stop the Crusaders from breaking into the sarcophagi of the buried emperors, including Constantine, Justinian and Theodora, Heraclius and many others. The invaders were surprised to find Justinian's body still intact, with no signs of rot. The bodies themselves were untouched. But the precious objects Alexius III didn't dare to touch were taken to the pile of spoils. Every church was ransacked, including the great Hagia Sophia, with its great golden altar, engraved with the colors of 72 pearls, cut into pieces and carted off on mules. The heavy load and slippery marble floor caused some of the animals to slip and fall, and before long, the floor of the temple was covered in blood and excrements. The empire was dead, and now the vultures were dismembering its corpse. Countless marble statues and columns were shipped off and sold. The harbor chain that protected the Golden Horn was separated into pieces and delivered to Acre alongside the very gates of the city. Doors, furniture, silk, and other valuables were also sold or sent back to the west. The Catholics found no interest in icons, which were not nearly as popular in the Catholic world, so they destroyed or desecrated a vast quantity of them to the dismay of the local populace. And yet, the biggest tragedy was what they did to the numerous bronze works of art throughout the city. Giant statues, symbolizing authority, beauty, strength, and wisdom, were thrown into the smelters and melted down to be turned into cheap copper coins. Among them were a statue of Hera, charioteers, a man wrestling with a lion, a monument celebrating Actium, a statue of Aphrodite being handed the golden apple of discord by Paris of Troy, a bronze statue of the she-wolf suckling the founders of Rome, a tetrapylon built by Theodosius with a beautiful facade that depicted birds, sheep, lamb, fish, as well as mythological creatures and figures, with a large bronze pyramid and a female figure that acted as a weather vane showing the direction of the wind. This is just the beginning of the list. Among the lost cultural items was a crocodile with prickly bronze scales clutching a struggling African buffalo in its jaws. The Nile bull, as the locals called it, attempted to break free by biting the crocodile, both killing each other in the process, neither achieving its goal. Another smelted art piece was a large statue that stood at the base of the Forum of Theodosius, depicting the hero of the ancient Greek myth Bellerophon as he gazed towards the sun, riding the winged Pegasus, alongside a large bronze eagle with extended wings and a coiled snake in its claws. The latter also served as a sundial, with its wings split into 12 sections, from which the observer could determine the hour of the day. Also lost was a massive bronze sculpture made by the legendary Lysippos, the personal sculptor of Alexander the Great, whose pupil constructed the Colossus of Rhodes. Lysippos created a giant Heracles with a lion skin over him and a club in his hands. His shin was as tall as a man, and a man's belt could go around his thumb. The masterpiece was cut piece by piece and thrown into the fire like all the rest. Sphinxes, sea monsters, and other mythological creatures were also destroyed. For the description of the last notable statue, we turn to the contemporary chronicler. What of the white-armed, beautiful-ankled, and long-necked Helen, who mustered the entire host of the Hellenes and overthrew Troy, whence she sailed to the Nile and after a long absence returned to the abodes of the Laconians? Was she able to placate the implacable? Was she able to soften those men whose hearts were made of iron? On the contrary, she who had enslaved every onlooker with her beauty was wholly unable to achieve this, even though she was apparelled ornately. Though fashioned of bronze, she appeared as fresh as the morning dew, anointed with the moistness of erotic love on her garment, veil, diadem, and braid of hair. Her vesture was finer than spiderwebs, and the veil was cunningly wrought in its place. The diadem of gold and precious stones which bound the forehead was radiant, and the braid of hair that extended down to her knees, flowing down and blowing in the breeze, was bound tightly in the back with a hairband. The lips were like flower cups, slightly parted as though she were about to speak. The graceful smile, at once greeting the spectator, filled him with delight. Her flashing eyes, her arched eyebrows, and the shapeliness of the rest of her body were such that they cannot be described in words and depicted for future generations. O Helen, Tyndareus's daughter, the very essence of loveliness, offshoot of Eretes, ward of Aphrodite, nature's most perfect gift, the contested prize of Trojans and Hellenes, where is your drug granted you by Thon's wife, which banishes pain and sorrow and brings forgetfulness of every ill? Where are your irresistible love charms? Why did you not make use of these now as you did long ago? But I suspect that the fates had foredained that you should succumb to the flame's fervor, so that your image should no longer arouse spectators' sexual passions. It is said that these Anidae condemned you to the flames as retribution for Troy's having been laid waste by the firebrand because of your scandalous amours. But the gold madness of these men does not allow me to conceive and utter such a thing, for that madness was the reason why rare and excellent works of art everywhere were given over to total destruction. Considering the extensive list of art that was present all over the city, in the Forum, Hippodrome, overlooking the streets and churches, it's easy to see why the citizens of the Empire considered themselves Roman. The Fourth Crusade didn't just demolish monuments, it struck a blow against their identity, severing their ties with antiquity. One of the few bronze works of art that were not thrown into the smelters was the quadriga. These were four life-sized bronze-gilded horses, originally sat on the top of Hadrian's mausoleum, before they were moved to the Hippodrome. The Venetians took these horses, cut off their heads, and transported them to Venice, where they were reassembled and put on top of the St. Mark Church, with collars on their neck to hide the cut. The brilliant works of art overlooked the city until history once again repeated itself. Napoleon took control of Venice in 1797 and forcibly removed the statues, along with an immense quantity of art from all over Italy. Yet again, gold and silver objects were melted down to pay for soldiers' salaries, but the Chariot of the Gods was placed on top of the newly commissioned Arc de Triomphe before it was returned to Venice following the Congress of Vienna. Along with the horses, St. Mark's Basilica was decorated with the Carmignola, four life-size sculptures of the Tetrarchs, and marvelous pillars of Acca. Additionally, Venice also sees the Colossus of Barletta, a massive bronze statue of either Marcion or Leo I, which washed up on the beach of Barletta after the ship that carried it sank. This clearly shows that unlike the rest of the Crusaders, the Venetians preferred to preserve the bronze statues rather than smelt them and turn them into coins. One theory suggests that the reason behind this was that the Franks considered the great bronze statues to glorify polytheism, making them go out of their way to destroy them for very little monetary gain. But Venice was not the only one that got to bring trophies home. Over the next few decades, many artifacts were shipped off to the West. The head relics and bones of multiple patriarchs and saints, including Andrew, the patron saint of Constantinople, were taken by various cardinals and clergymen. Conrad of Krosigk, Bishop of Halberstadt, was one of the crusaders who sacked the city, and a year later he returned home, enriching his cathedral with several precious artifacts. The blood of Christ, a strand of the Virgin Mary's hair, pieces of the true cross, the crown of thorns, his purple robe, and his sandals, along with other objects attributed to various apostles and saints, several gold discs, and two ivory panels. Traditionally, splinters of the true cross were stored in special precious containers, which the Crusaders scattered to Limburg, Trier, Koblenz, Amiens, and Rome, with the largest of them going to Paris. The French city also obtained the mysterious Shroud of Turin, bearing the negative image of a man, leading many to believe that this was the burial shroud that Jesus was wrapped in. Paris received many other great artifacts, a majority of which were destroyed during the French Revolution centuries later. Robert of Clary was a low-born French knight who provided us with a glimpse of the treasures that were lost to us. Not even one person above earth, as much as he had lived in this city, would be able to count and tell the riches, because whoever narrated even the slightest about this wealth, about the beauty and precious things that were found in the monasteries, churches and palaces, and in the city, would appear a liar and not one would believe him. Another account of one of the leaders of the crusade tells us how the great heaps of spoils were split in half, with the crusaders receiving 150,000, of which 50,000 went to Venice, alongside their own share of 150,000 marks. But this figure does not account for all the precious treasures that were destroyed, melted, sold, or shipped off. In reality, this was arguably the greatest loss of art in human history. When the Western Roman Empire fell, Constantinople became a bastion of knowledge and art, keeping the secrets of both behind its tall walls. The Fourth Crusade opened those walls and spread the spoils all over Western Europe, arguably setting the foundation of the Renaissance. The stone and marble statues were cut, the bronze marvels smelted, the churches and palaces were plundered, and now the Crusaders were preparing to divide the land and elect the first emperor of this new Latin Empire to spread their reign over the remnants of the shattered Roman one. In our next video, we will talk about this partition and the reaction of the local polities to it, including the famous Battle of Adrianople of 1205. So make sure you are subscribed and have pressed the bell button to see the next video in the series. Please consider liking, commenting, and sharing, it helps immensely. Our videos would be impossible without our kind patrons and YouTube channel members, whose ranks you can join via the links in the description to know our schedule, get early access to our videos, access our Discord, and much more. This is the Kings and Generals channel, and we will catch you on the next one.